Salaam alaikum. Thank you very much for inviting me to such an important event. I'll start with a little disclaimer. I am not a policy expert, I'm a campaigner, and I was elected to the National Union of Students on a mandate to campaign against the Prevent Duty, and it's a campaign that we take very seriously indeed. So I'm going to give you an overview of what's happening in education, and more specifically what's happening to my members as students, and then I'm going to talk about what we're trying to do to overcome it. So as of this year, as part of the Counter-terrorism and Security Act, the government has made the Prevent Duty mandatory in colleges and universities. And now staff are legally obliged to monitor and report anything that they believe could be a sign of extremism. And its remit includes education, but it extends further to all aspects of the public sector, as well as the private and charity sectors. Prevent is supposed to concern itself with all types of extremism, but all evidence shows that through training and reporting, the real focus is on Muslim students. Since 2005, it's undergone some small changes, partly in response to criticisms, but it has still not addressed the substantive point of that criticism, that Prevent is facilitating Islamophobia in the very spaces which are supposed to challenge, inform, and educate students about difference and about tolerance. So what is extremism according to Prevent? And I quote, "Vocal or active opposition to fundamental British values, including democracy and mutual respect of different faiths and beliefs." But at what point does ideological opposition to any of these develop into acts of violence? According to the government, it's after contact with radicalisers and attending events with extremist speakers. The government believes that extremism is bred at universities, but there is no proof that walking into a lecture theatre to learn is any more a radicalising experience than walking into Tesco's to get a sandwich. According to academic research, it's far more complicated than that, but the government won't let evidence get in the way of its policy. So how does Prevent Duty manifest in the education setting? In universities and colleges, its recommendations include, but are not exclusive to, counsellors referring students with signs of withdrawal, keeping tabs on the content that students access online, and monitoring the activities of prayer rooms. It also recommends institutions assign a Prevent officer if they don't already have one, and all staff are required to receive training. And to give you an idea of the scale of this project, there are not enough Prevent officers in the country to train every public sector worker, so private companies are now springing up in recent months offering to outsource this training. So you've got private companies making a profit from Prevent. I'm going to give you some examples of Prevent at work in education. I'm sure many of you will have heard of these instances. A 14-year-old Muslim boy who was in a class learning about environmental activism mentioned the word eco-terrorism and was referred to Prevent officers for questioning. We had three Muslim girls at New Vic College who sent a student and staff email complaining about Prevent. They were suspended from college. A boy came into school wearing a Palestine solidarity badge handing out pro-Palestine literature. He was referred to Prevent for questioning. Mohammed Umar Farouk, a postgraduate student at Staffordshire University, studying for his postgrad course, learning about counter-terrorism, was seen in the library reading a book about terrorism. He was referred to Prevent officers for questioning. Now, I think if you're training up to be a terrorist, you wouldn't be as obvious to sit in the library reading a book about it, but there you go, I'm not a Prevent officer. A three-year-old has been referred to Prevent after his parents were suspected, so we've got toddlers now being referred to anti-radicalisation training. A 10-year-old was recently referred for asking why there wasn't a prayer room in his school. At another university, the captains of every sports team were called into a meeting with management and asked to sign a contract promising to report any of their teammates who showed signs of radicalisation. At another university, in the prayer room, the campuses had cameras installed for monitoring purposes. At one college, the student union was called by the local police and asked for the names of all of their Islamic society members. A sixth former who came to one of my workshops about Prevent a couple of weeks ago told me that she's been referred to counter-terrorism training because she was seen on Facebook posting about white privilege, and when the Prevent officer spoke to her, they had printouts of all of her kind of online activity. And as I've attended these kind of Prevent workshops right across the UK, in the last couple of months, I've heard countless instances like these. I'm sure many of you will have had similar ones. And what Prevent is doing is creating a culture of surveillance and of suspicion and division amongst student communities. The government says that this agenda is about more than just Islamic extremism, and that it focuses on the far right as well, which is actually responsible for the majority of acts of terror across Europe. But almost every case we hear of referrals to prevent involves black and Muslim and international students, especially if they're politicised. So the NUT, the National Union of Teachers, has reported that some of their members in receiving prevent training have been told to watch out for students who start going along to Palestine demonstrations, for instance. And clearly, some of the signs of radicalisation are not just about attending certain events, demonstrations, but include just appearing Muslim. So if a student then starts adhering more strictly to their faith, starts wearing a hijab, growing a beard, praying 5 times a day, are they then likely to be a suspect? Are they going to be referred? So what are we doing? Last month, David Cameron announced new funding streams to counter-terror that he'll be making available to various organisations. And I think this is a way of prevent creeping into all types of sectors, so that anyone could essentially be a prevent informant by any other name. And the government is trying to give this kind of acceptable veneer to what has become a very toxic brand. At the National Union of Students, we were recently offered a grant from the government's Preventing Extremism Department to deliver work with students of faith, a grant of £100,000. And we had to ask ourselves, why would such funding be offered to students of faith at a time when this government is so clearly antagonising the Muslim community with the narrative of collective responsibility and so on? And so we rejected the money. And I would encourage any organisation with a moral code to do the same. But just rejecting money won't stop the duty being carried out on campuses, of course. So what are we doing locally? Our policy at NUS is for non-compliance, and we are asking all of our member unions to take up this policy. And similar to the ECU, which is the lecturers' trade union, who are also opposed to prevent, as if their members have already got their work cut out marking students' work without having to also spy on them. They are providing advice to their members on balloting for a boycott of prevent. And together with the ECU, with our Black Students Campaign, Defend the Right to Protest, and the Federation of Student Islamic Societies, we launched the Students Not Suspects tour to spread the word about prevent and inform our members. And it's just finished. We went all around the country. We had over 600 attendees at our events, with more than 30 student unions involved, and we built up what is quite genuinely a very grassroots campaign. Now, though, we need further actions and support groups creating to help students bear the brunt of this duty. So as well as advising on how to establish those support networks, we've called a National Day of Action on December the 7th, and we're encouraging unions who haven't to pass preventing prevent policy, to hold meetings with their trade unions on campus, to host teach-outs, alternative lectures to challenge the standard narratives, organise creative stunts, protest petitions, whatever they want to do really, whatever you want to do as well if you want to get involved. And if you can, please check out the hashtag StudentsNotSuspects for more information. In the Prevent Duty Guidance, it states extremism can be defined as vocal or active opposition to the rule of law. And I say that there are some rules of law and some laws that need to be broken. So at NUS, we'll be doing all of this and more in order to force this policy off our campuses and demonstrate that we are students, not suspects. Thank you.